Hello and welcome to our very different Synod service for this year, 2020. I'm gathered here with our Bishop, Mark, with members of the Bishop's Leadership Team, and James Damon from Mudgee, Bishop's Evangelist. We've heard our presidential address, and now this liturgy, this service, will be a time for us to respond and reflect to the words that our Bishop has brought to us. Romans 15, verses 5 to 6. May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had, so that with one mind and one voice you may glorify the Lord and God of our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. We'll now sing a beautiful old hymn, Lord for the Years. As we sing this hymn, may we really take in the words that are written. Past put behind us, for the future take us, Lord of our lives, to live for Christ alone. Let us think of the past. Friends in Christ, we come together to meet with God, to take our part in the building up of his church. We'll lift up our hearts in thanks and praise, hear from God's holy word, and pray for this world and for ourselves. In the light of our Bishop's Synod address, in this service, we look back at the past with lament and repentance, consider our present situation with humility and dependence, and look to the future with hope and commitment. The Bible tells us to approach God confidently through our Lord Jesus Christ. As we do so, we must confess our sins, seeking forgiveness through God's boundless goodness and mercy. Our Bishop exhorted us to confession this morning this way. Perhaps you've been judgmental and harsh in regard to past decision makers and power brokers. Perhaps you have spoken maliciously or falsely of others, or indulged in gossip and the spreading of rumours. Perhaps you're part of certain decision-making groups in our past, but have never, with humility, admitted any fault. Perhaps you've sought attention for yourself at the expense of the gospel or relationships. Perhaps you have a sense of entitlement and let fly when things don't happen the way you like. You may have been an abuser, but have never admitted it. You may have withheld forgiveness, hanging on to rage or malice. You may have chosen to withdraw from relationship instead of seeking the costly way of reconciliation. Perhaps you are holding on to hurt and anger, and your disappointment in past or present leaders is impacting your ability to get on now and serve the Lord with joy. Remember this: if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. So let us draw near to God with sincerity and confidence and pray together. God of all mercy, we humbly admit that we need your help. We have wandered from your way. We have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and have failed to do what is right. You alone can save us. Have mercy on us. Wipe out our sins and teach us to forgive others. Bring forth in us the fruit of your Spirit, that we may live the new life to your glory. This we ask in the name of Jesus, our Saviour. Amen.
God desires that none should perish, but that all should turn to Christ and live. God pardons those who humbly repent and truly believe the gospel. Therefore, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the perfect offering for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever.
From the chaos of darkness, your word shaped the earth, in your image a people made. But we traded perfection, truth for a lie, and your glory was veiled in shame. But a promise made, a blessing you gave to a people of your name. For this broken world, a Savior foretold to bear all our grief and pain. When the heavenly Savior descended His throne, all my sin on His shoulders lay. And to win our redemption, He suffered and died for the sake of my guilt and shame. Oh, the price He paid in taking my place, so that death I will rest in your glorious grace. For the song we raise, the works of our hands.
have learnt this morning something of the present situation of our diocese. We pray for God's transforming work among us, using some of the classic Anglican collects. Let us pray. Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that encouraged and supported by your holy word, we may embrace and always hold fast the joyful hope of everlasting life, which you have given in our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. Raise up your great power, Lord, and come among us to save us, that although through our sins we are grievously hindered in running the race that is set before us, your plentiful grace and mercy may speedily help and deliver us through the sufficiency of your Son, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honour and glory now and forever. Amen. Heavenly Father, keep your household, the Church, continually in your true religion, that those who lean only on the hope of your heavenly grace may always be defended by your mighty power. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Lord, you have taught us that whatever we do without love is worth nothing. Send your Holy Spirit and pour into our hearts that most excellent gift of love, the true bond of peace and of all virtues, without which whoever lives is counted dead before you. Grant this for your only Son, Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. Amen. Almighty God, we confess that we have no power of ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities that may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts that may assault and hurt the soul, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Heavenly Father, the giver of all good things, fill our hearts with thankfulness and grant that by your Holy Spirit we may think those things are good, and by your merciful guidance may perform them, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we are to pray, and constantly give more than either we desire. Pour down on us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things which we are not worthy to ask, except through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Amen.
As we now look to the future, we hear from St. Andrew's Cathedral Choir the beautiful words of "The Lord is my shepherd." The Lord is our shepherd for this time and the future.
And deep. Bible reading comes from Philippians chapter 1, verse 27 to chapter 2, verse 11. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in the one spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved, and that by God, for it has been granted to you on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, since you are going through the same struggle you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, and that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our Heavenly Father, as we open this passage now, please give us wisdom that we might understand what it is saying, and humility that we might hear what you want to say to us through your word today. In Jesus' name, Amen. In my Synod address, I quoted from Romans 15, 5 to 6. You're probably getting quite familiar with it now. May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had. And to that end, that with one mind and one voice, we might glorify God. But let me ask, what was that attitude of mind that Christ Jesus had? Did you notice that Paul commends almost the precise behaviour in Philippians 2, which Karen just read? Chapter 2, verse 5, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. Paul's passion in his letter to the Philippians is to see the gospel advance, to know that the good news of Jesus is being proclaimed, even though there are challenges and opposition. So he says in chapter 1, verse 27, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel. That is, live consistently with what you believe. That is to define us as God's people. That is to make us stand out. Look, there are those people that live consistently with what they believe. Because Paul wants to hear that the Philippian Christians stand firm in one spirit, and then verse 27, contending as one for the faith of the gospel. So what will it look like if we are to conduct ourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel? Well, we see it when we get to chapter 2. Have a look, verse 2, make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider one another's or value one another above yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel. It's a call for the church as a whole, so that we may as one contend for the gospel. Oh, friends, that we would take this on across central and western New South Wales as people of the Diocese of Bathurst. Like-minded, on the same page, knowing our purpose and direction, all of us aware that we're on about making disciples across the length and breadth of the diocese, and all of us pulling together, one in spirit and purpose, having the same love, that is, love for God. No one pushing their own agenda, no individual after their own glory, every individual valuing others above themselves. That's what it will mean to conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel. Can you imagine a church like that? But remember the reason. Not so they can have a nice time together, but so that they might contend as one for the gospel. An SAS crack team. They work together as one. There is mateship. They're one in purpose, looking out for each other. No private agendas. It's all teamwork. An Olympic relay team work together as one. No individual heroes, working as one. The bobsled team in the Winter Olympics. They all have to work together as one unit. Friends, that's what it's to be like for us as church. I have this image of all of us standing arm in arm, locked together to embrace central and western New South Wales, proclaiming as one, look, no matter what you think about God, he loves you. He may be irrelevant to you, but you are not irrelevant to him. United, inspired, pumped, excited, filled with love, with a sense of urgency about us, thick as thieves, but for the best possible cause in the world. But that does take something special for a group of people to work together like that. It takes something so special across a diocese for people to have that mindset, that one mind, that one spirit, that one purpose. Because sometimes we all come with our own agendas. We come to church looking for our needs to be met. We have our own particular views on how things ought to be done in church. We want things done our way and for us, thank you. And church becomes about meeting my needs, fulfilling my desires. So I'll come if it suits. I'll be involved when it suits, and when it doesn't, well, I'm out. There's the other problem. We see church as something that we turn up to, not as something we are as Christ's body. Friends, church cannot be possibly something that we turn up for an hour on Sundays. No, church is alive. We are a living body. How is it described in 1 Peter that we are living stones, each and every one of us being built into a spiritual temple? We together are God's special treasured people set aside to declare God's praises to the rest of the world, so that more and more people will join us as living stones and the church will rise up and grow to his great glory. So what needs to happen for a diocese to contend as one for the gospel? What does it take for a diocese to be like-minded, one in spirit and purpose? It needs to think like Christ, to have the mind of Christ, the same attitude as Christ. So look with me again at verse 5. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Now, we can learn a lot about Jesus here, who he is, what he did, what it means to be in very nature God and yet not use that to his own advantage, but that's not directly Paul's purpose. Paul's purpose is to exhort his readers, both then and us now, to have the same humility in the service of others and in our relationships that Jesus demonstrated so powerfully in leaving the glory that he enjoyed from eternity with his Father to step into the muck of our world. That kind of humility that lets go of status or privilege, that kind of humility that sees you take on the role of servant, that kind of humility that lays down your life, So can you imagine, friends, the Lord of the universe, the creator and sustainer of the universe, the one through whom and for whom everything was made. He's been with his Father in his heavenly kingdom from eternity. He's the one who's numbered your days and counted your hairs. He is majestic. He is mighty. He is powerful. And yet this one didn't use his status to his own advantage. He let go of any rights or claims on deity so that he could take on servanthood. He forewent all his rights and privileges to take on human likeness. But the descent went further. He humbled himself further. In obedience to his Father, he went to his death. Not just any death, but that on a Roman cross, the most shameful of all deaths. From the highest of heights to the lowest of lows, for us. Paul says, have this mindset. Think like this. Follow that example of humility, that example of serving the needs of others before yourself, that example of valuing others ahead of you. That is what is needed as we contend as one for the gospel. This is such a radical challenge to the way we think, putting aside any status we might have from the world. In our diocese, we have policemen and politicians and academics and graziers and farmers and educationalists and medical health workers and administrators and journalists and musicians and priests and deacons in our churches, some who love to tell you of their great achievements and what a great contribution they've made to the world and to society. But having the same mindset as Jesus means putting that aside, not considering any of that as something to be clung onto or that matters. It's nothing. But considering ourselves first and foremost as a servant. Oh, what do you do? Well, I'm a servant. And you, what do you do? I'm a servant. And you, what about you? I'm a servant. Humbling yourself to serve the needs of others, to serve the cause of the gospel, to contend together from an equal footing for the gospel. In team sports, you wear one uniform. It doesn't matter where you are or who you are outside the arena. Here in the team, we're all heading in the one direction, the same cause, together working in one direction. That goes for people in the SES, fire and rescue, surf lifesavers. No, as God's people, we don't have a uniform as such in terms of clothes, but we are to clothe ourselves with servanthood. It's not about me. It's about Jesus. It's not about me. It's about those who need to hear the good news, the best news. It's about the greatest need that there is out here in the West. The greatest need among all the needs that there are is for people to hear the news of Jesus and to find the forgiveness and reconciliation with God that we have been privileged to find. Nothing will transform society like people coming into relationship with Jesus. The more we follow the example of Christ, who let go of all his rights and privileges, even his very life, because he valued others, then the more too we will be united, as Paul spells out here. Who is this one whose example we should embrace? Jesus. Is he worthy? Yes, he is. Is he worthy of our imitation? Should we take any notice of his example? Should he hold sway over us? Absolutely. For this one who humbled himself for us, we remember and we celebrate that God has taken him and highly exalted him. Verse 9. Have a look with me. God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Here is the consistent pattern and promise of the Bible, that everyone who humbles themselves will be exalted. That pattern is centered on Jesus and continues on from him. Jesus humbled himself as low as he could, but God exalted him to the highest place and seated him at the right hand of God. And before him, everyone will bow. Richard Dawkins, the famous atheist, will one day bow the knee to Jesus. President Trump will one day bow the knee to Jesus. That atheist friend of yours, that agnostic and apathetic family member, they will bow the knee to Jesus. And possibly in hushed tones, overwhelmed at the awesome reality, they will confess, they will acknowledge with their tongues, that is, they'll actually mouth the words, Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. And God will be glorified. My dear brothers and sisters, as your new bishop and shepherd and pastor, I want to urge us to conduct ourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel, standing firm in one spirit, contending as one for the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose us. We'll only do this as we are like-minded, have the same love, being one in spirit and purpose, as we do nothing from selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility value others above ourselves and look to the interests of others. This will only happen as we follow the amazing, staggering humility of our Lord Jesus, who let go of his status and his rights and his privileges to become a servant, obedient even to death. When we together put aside our status, our rights, our privileges, and put on servanthood, becoming servants of Christ and one another and of our communities, then united we will contend as one for the gospel. We will with one mind and one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. That great God, before whom every knee will one day bow and everyone mouth the words, Jesus is Lord. Amen.
Let us now affirm our faith. Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. All things were created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. For it pleased God that in him all fullness should dwell, and through him all things be reconciled to himself. We come now to the time of prayer. Let us pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Because the Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. Goodness and mercy will follow me all my days, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Grant that we may live a life worthy of the gospel and strive as one for the work of the gospel. Help us to become one in spirit and mind, doing nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Grant us to have the same mindset which was in Christ Jesus, who made himself nothing, taking the nature of a servant. We continue in prayer.
Dear Father, we thank you so much for your amazing grace shown to us in the Lord Jesus Christ's death for us. We ask that you would enable the gospel to so penetrate our hearts that we are filled with passion to share the good news and bless the West and make disciples of Jesus. We ask that you would enable us to do this clearly. Thank you for this huge privilege that you give us to be a part of your mission, and thank you for your presence with us as we go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us pray that the Lord of the harvest may send more workers. Lord of the harvest, we see that your harvest field is ripe and ready all over central and western New South Wales and the world. We long to see your kingdom come on this earth and to do everything we can to obey your commission to go into the world, making disciples of all nations. Help us to consider serving you by answering your call to serve, or to generously release our funds so that others might be sent to share the gospel in our diocese. May we, as individuals, as families, and as your church, respond to your command in whatever way you call us. You have told us through Scripture that the harvest is plentiful, so we know that the harvest is plentiful and powerful. Show us how to pray effectively for the protection, boldness, clarity, health and fruitfulness of our ministers, both lay and clergy. May we actively seek to align ourselves with your heart and respond to the need. We pray that our hearts would be obedient to the desires of your heart, so that all people would come to a saving knowledge of the truth, the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose powerful name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray, giving thanks for the Sydney gift. Gracious God, through the Holy Spirit you bless us with many gifts. We give you thanks for the gift of generosity. And we give thanks especially for the generosity of the Diocese of Sydney, for their continual support of our diocese and their support of gospel ministry in the Central West. May we use their gift wisely to promote the gospel to all those we meet. Teach us, Lord, to be good stewards of our resources, and that we would set aside any prejudice and misunderstanding and seek only you. We humbly pray, Father, that our diocese might continue to be blessed with gospel-centered people and financial resources, so that people's hearts would receive the message of salvation and that the gospel might grow and prosper in our diocese, so that the name of Jesus might be above all others to your glory. And we ask this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray that we will fix our eyes on Jesus and give glory to God with one heart and one voice. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness and for your steadfast love. You assure us that we are not alone, that as our shepherd, you are there with rod and staff, giving us comfort, calling us back to you. When things of the world distract us, when our past holds us back from becoming the people that you call us to be, when we become consumed with the world's standards, rather than with the one who holds all life, all love and all power. Draw us back, inspire and strengthen us, that we may fix our eyes on you and proclaim your word in unity and with one voice to the glory of your name. We ask this in the name of Jesus, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Faithful God, you've promised to hear the prayers of all who ask in Jesus' name. In your mercy, accept our prayers. Grant us what we've asked in faith, according to your will, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Let us join together in the rousing hymn, O for a Thousand Tongues to Sing.
Oh, that we had a thousand tongues to sing our great Redeemer's praise. I trust that this Synod service has been an inspiration and a help to you today. And my thanks to Archdeacon Brett Watterson and to all of those who have been involved in leading us today. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.